Welcome everyone to another Star Wars The Old Republic video, and this video is going to be about the new United Forces campaign that was just announced in the roadmap today, which is just a fancy word for server merges, and all of the juicy details regarding how exactly the server merges will go down, you will find all of them in this video. So let's get right into it. So the server merge is going to be a gradual process starting on October 10th, but the time you will actually see the visible change will be November 8th. That is when the server merges will actually be implemented. That is when you will actually be affected. And there's a lot of nuances to get into, like how will character renames work, how will guild and other stuff change, and we'll get into that a little bit later, but quickly, I just want to announce that when the United Forces campaign actually launches, it will be a chance to earn some pretty unique rewards, and they're quite easy to get. So for example, if you just log into the game after the update is launched on November 8th, you will get a new pet, the Mini Mogul NM1, which is inspired by the Karaga's Palace operation. You'll also get the Darth Hexed Companion if you complete an achievement, and that achievement is simply to either do 3 PvE missions or 3 PvP war zones via group finder. So very easy to do, takes you very little time, and you're going to get the Darth Hexed Companion, which is the dark versus light companion that wasn't given to us last summer because obviously Master Reynos won. So that's going to be a very easy companion to get basically. They'll also get a few achievements like United Forces Group Recon achievement or the United Forces Warzone Recon. And then when the United Forces goes live, you will have 1 week of double XP, double CXP, double Valor, and all that other good stuff. Alright, so now that we got that out of the way with, let's get into the actual interesting stuff, which is, for example, how will the servers change exactly? So the Harbinger, the Bedroom Colony, and the Bastion. All three of those will be merged into the Hot Prospect, and that is the first North American server. Jedi Covenant, Shadowlands, Ebonhawk, Prophecy of the Five, and Jung Ma will all become the new Starforge server, and that's also North American. Then we're also getting three new European servers, Progenitor, Tomb of Freedom Nod, and Red Eclipse. Those will all become the Darth Malgus, which is, and this is the English-speaking European server. Mantle of the Force, Battle Meditation, and Darth Nihilus, those become the Leviathan, which is the French-speaking European server. And then T3-M4, Vangevala's Chain, and Jarkai Sword will become Tulok Horde, that is the German-speaking European server. Now the obvious benefits about server merges like this is if you're stuck on a dead server, you finally have some salvation, you'll be able to actually do the things that make Star Wars such a great MMO, like for example, war zones and flashpoints and stuff. Also, if you're just a normal player, you'll actually have a better chance at jumping into war zones. They'll pop faster, flashpoints will pop faster and all that good stuff. So there are many obvious benefits, but also the downside will be hopefully they can actually implement this smoothly. I mean, it would suck if we start seeing some major server disruptions and servers going down and all that stuff. So I'm glad they're making it a gradual process. They're, you know, going to be testing it out and all that stuff. They have all of October to do it, basically, so hopefully they don't screw it up, let's put it that way. Alright, so let's get into character names, because that is arguably the most controversial aspect of this, because the bottom line is some people are going to lose their names and are going to be unhappy about it, but I think that's just a sacrifice that some of us are going to have to make in order for server merges to happen. But here's how it's going to work. They will not allow two of the same names on a server. So the way that they're going to do it is one person will be forced to rename their character if that collision happens. And it's going to work on a priority system. So firstly, obviously, subscribers are going to have priority over free-to-play or preferred players. But secondly, if two players are a subscriber, the more highly played character will get to keep their name. So if I'm on the Harbinger with a character name and someone from Bedroom Colony comes on over with the same name, the more highly played character will be able to keep their name, the other person will be forced to rename. It's not an entirely fair system because obviously someone who spends like their entire day playing SWTOR versus a more casual player only spends a few hours, that more highly played character is obviously going to get to keep the names of all of his characters. And some of us do get attached to our character names and stuff. So it's going to suck. But either way, once again, that's just the price we're going to have to pay for server merges. And that is how it's going to work. Now, one step that they're taking to kind of limit the amount of character names that are going to be forced to rename is that they're going to prompt people to remove the names of their characters that have not been played for 90 days or more. So for those of us who have been entirely inactive, haven't played for like a really long time, they are not going to be able to keep their names. Also, those characters have to be below level 10 as well. So if you're above level 10, you're good. But if you're a player that's below level 10, have been inactive for 90 days, you will be forced to rename your character. Now, they also confirmed that this will have no impact on your guild, your guild bank, your achievements, or your strongholds. So that was kind of a simple way of putting it. They're not going to change it, but there are going to be some things you need to keep in mind. So for example, with your characters, you're capped at 52. You can't have more than 52 characters on your server. But when the server merge happens, the way they're doing it for this and also for a whole bunch of other stuff is they will obviously not delete your characters. You'll be able to have more than 52 characters on your server, but it's still capped at 52. So for example, if you want to create a new character on, say, the new Hot Prospect server, but you have like 80 characters already, you're gonna have to delete characters until you get below 52, and then you can create a new character. So just to make it very clear, I'll give you guys a quick example. I'm on the Harbinger, I'll be moved to the Hot Prospect server, and let's say, for example, I now have 70 characters. Now, if I want to create the 71 character, I want to create a new level 1 character and level, I'm going to have to delete 19 characters before I can create my new level 1 character. So basically, if you have a lot of characters spread over a ton of servers, you will not be able to create new characters on the new server if you want to keep all of your old characters. Hopefully that made sense. You'll get a better sense of this because this is the same process they're taking for all of the other stuff that's capped as well. So we'll just jump to another example. For example, your strongholds. So if you have a whole ton of strongholds across different servers, they all get merged and you have exceeded the cap of strongholds, you will still be able to keep all of your strongholds. They will all remain decorated. No resets will happen. However, if you want to activate a new stronghold, then you're going to have to delete all of your old strongholds until you get below the cap once again. In my opinion, it's not the best system, but I also think it's not going to be the biggest problem because I don't think there is a huge number of players out there that actually play hardcore across a bunch of different servers. Most players stick to just one server and do all their stuff there. In terms of some of the other stuff like friend lists will continually be updated with if players are forced to change their character names or whatever, so your friend list won't really be affected. Your ignore list won't really be affected either. Galactic Trade Network listings will not be affected at all. However, obviously you will see a lot more listings on your server. I actually want to talk about that at the end of this video if that's what you were interested in, because obviously the GTN is a huge part of my channel and a huge part of what I enjoy doing in the game. So I have a lot of stuff to talk about that, but I'll leave that all for the end. Your mailbox won't be affected either. Your appearance designer stamped appearances, which usually get reset, is actually not going to be reset, so those will be fine as well. Character transfers will still work with the new update. They'll be disabled for a little while because I don't think they want, you know, they need to make sure there aren't going to be major problems or anything. However, they will reactivate it again later, and I don't know if it's going to still cost 90 cartel coins. Maybe it's going to cost back to its normal 1000 cartel coins. I don't know, but we'll see. And then in terms of your legacy name and level obviously won't change. Your legacy name can be duplicated. Like if I have a legacy name, there could be like 100 people that have the same legacy name. It doesn't matter. But your level, guys. So if your higher level legacy will be the one that's preserved. It's the same way it works for character transfers. Your legacy unlocks will be completely unaffected as well. Your legacy currencies will just be added together. Your legacy bank, once again, will just kind of be added together as well. But if you have, they haven't really told us the intricate details, but what they did say was, for example, if you have a legacy banks filled to the brim on numerous servers, it won't delete those items. It'll enter a new type of legacy bank called your legacy overflow. And basically, you can just keep taking things out of the legacy overflow until you've got everything back, but it's important to note you won't be able to put things in there. It's just a place for storage so you don't lose your items. So that's the way that the legacy banks are going to be combined. Once again, not many details, so we'll have to see what actually happens. Like, how do you access the legacy overflow? Is it a separate bank? Is it going to be like the item stash just available on your toolbar? We don't know. Also, in terms of achievements, all of your complete achievements will remain intact. And if you have an achievement in progress, it will be completely unaffected. Strongholds and decorations. So as we mentioned about strongholds earlier, you know, you'll be able to keep all of your strongholds. You'll even be able to have two of the same strongholds. So if I have two Dromund-Kaas strongholds decorated, I'll be able to go to actually both of them and have access to both of them. But if I want to activate a new stronghold, I've got to delete all my old ones until I get below the cap. And I believe the cap is 6. So you can only have really 6 active strongholds. Decorations won't be impacted either. But decorations get a little bit weird as well, so listen a little bit carefully to this one. It can get a little bit confusing. So basically, first of all, your decorations won't combine. So if I have 15 statues on the Harbinger and 5 statues on the Bastion, I will only have, at the end of the server merge, 15 statues. It won't become 20. They're only going to keep the legacy that has the highest level, and they're only keeping the amount of decorations that have the highest number. So hopefully that makes sense. Those won't combine. So what that will ultimately lead to will be a situation where, for example, if you decide to keep all of your strongholds, you might only have 15 statues, but you actually have like 20 of them placed, because on your Harbinger's stronghold, you had 15 statues placed. On the Bastion, you had 5 statues placed in your stronghold. So at the end of the day, you have 20 statues placed down, but you only actually have 15 in your inventory. So the way that's going to work is, if you want to place down another decoration, you cannot do so until you've removed the decorations already placed down. Damn, I really hope I explained that well, but I probably didn't. You guys are probably sitting there scratching your heads going, what the hell did he say? But yeah, so for example, if I had 15 statues and 5 statues, I can't get to keep the 15 statues. But if I want to place another one of that statue down, I've got to delete all the statues from my Bastion stronghold, basically. So that's the way that's going to work. Because legacies are remaining unchanged, your reputation will remain unchanged as well. Your family trees will be reset, but I'm not really sure how many people even use family trees. The cartel market stash will work the same as everything else. Your cartel market stash items will all be combined, and even if you exceed 500, that's okay. But if you want to add more items to your item stash, you're going to need to take out items until you get back below under 500. Now, in terms of guilds, because that's one of the bigger things, as I mentioned earlier, there will really be no impact to guilds. If two guilds with the same name come on the same server, you will have the server designation next to the name. So if you are, for example, the Jedi Order, which is the example they gave here, it'll say the Jedi Order Bastion and then the Jedi Order Harbinger. So it just gives you your guild name at the end there. And then you have conquests. They're going to be running a new conquest called the Time of Peace that will run from October 24th to November 13th. Then after November 13th, your conquest will return back to normal. And then in terms of PvP ranked Season 9 and the leaderboards, PvP ranked Season 9 will just continue as planned, but you will retain the rank you had prior to the United Forces update. And then immediately following the update, the Season 9 leaderboard will appear blank. And then it will automatically update after you play your first ranked PvP match, and then you'll once again see your name on the leaderboard. So those are kind of the nuances and details of how exactly this is going to go down. I'm really sorry if I didn't explain it well. I know I can be confusing sometimes, and especially that stronghold stuff it's all a little confusing. So I'll leave the link to the actual article so you can read it yourself, hopefully get a better understanding of that. But the last thing I want to talk about before I decide to end this video is about the GTN. How is exactly the economy going to be affected? Is this a good thing or a bad thing? And I just want to quickly mention, and I'm only going to really focus on the Harbinger and the Red Eclipse economies, because those are kind of the flourishing ones right now. Everything else is kind of dead. So looking at the Harbinger, now keep in mind that the Harbinger is merging with the Bedrin Colony and the Bastion. Now we can completely disregard the Bastion because that is a dead server. I've been there. The GTN's dead. Everything's dead. So really saying that you're combining the Bastion with the Harbinger just means the Harbinger is going to stay the same. The big thing is the Bedrin Colony. Now the Bedrin Colony is an interesting server because it's got like a strong GTN and it's got a decent population, but it's not anywhere near Harbinger level. Like if you look on the Bedrin Colony, often the prices are really, really inflated because there's a lower population and so there's less people offering certain items. And so I think what we'll see is prices will kind of stay the same because sure, you'll get an influx of items from the Bedrin Colony, but you're not really getting a huge influx. It's not like you're merging the Red Eclipse with the Harbinger, which would destroy the economy. And you're also getting a decent population with the Bedrin Colony, so the supply and demand ideally should level out. But once again, we actually have to see how that plays in game, because there's a lot of motivations and stuff that you have to consider. For example, people coming from the Bedrin Colony are used to listing their items at higher prices than on the Harbinger. So when the server merge actually happens, you know, are people that came from the Bedrin Colony willing to list their items for lower prices, or will they be more kind of holding holding on to their items and waiting for prices to go up on the JTN. That's all stuff that we're going to have to see. But for the most part, the conclusion that I'm going to make for now is the Harbinger won't really be affected. This isn't a really big change that's happening. You know, merging a dead server and then a medium server with a high population server isn't going to be the biggest deal. And we might actually see some prices go down because the Bridging Colony is, at the end of the day, going to influx new items. And so we're going to be seeing, you know, double the amount, like, of platinum items. We're going to be seeing more hypercrates and stuff like that. Now, the other big thing is the Darth Malgus server. So they're combining Progenitor, Tomb of Freedom Nod, and Red Eclipse. Now, I haven't been on Tomb of Freedom Nod a lot, but I have checked out the Progenitor's GTN, and it's actually rather strong. There are really quite a few items on there. And I know the Red Eclipse right now has the cheapest prices in the entire game. Like, the Red Eclipse will give you items for super cheap. I've seen, like, Tithe Sabers go down below 20 mil. I've seen Hypercrates go the cheapest there. There's just, it's gonna be crazy. And so I think combining three rather strong servers with pretty strong GTNs together is gonna cause prices to go really, really low. And so I'll definitely have my eye out there for that one. And I'm probably gonna move on a character now with some credits and just have him sit there. And I wanna kind of be there to see what happens to the GTN, maybe pick up some really awesome deals, maybe do some credit exchange where I buy some cheap items on the new Darth Malgus server, jump over to the Hot Prospect server, gotta get used to the new names here, and maybe try to sell it for a profit. I don't know, it's gonna be exciting and fun, but I definitely think that the economy and GTN on the Red Eclipse is gonna be changed a lot more than the Harbinger. And right now, Red Eclipse is already a lot cheaper than Harbinger, so seeing this change is probably gonna make things actually go cheaper. I'm not sure about the populations on Progenitor and Tomb of Freedom Nod. If they have high populations, then it might offset the price change because there's gonna be more demand, but I'm not sure. From what I heard, Tomb of Freedom Nod is pretty much dead and Progenitor is kind of dying, so I don't know. It's going to be exciting nonetheless. With all of the other servers, I actually haven't checked the GTNs out that much, so I'm not sure exactly how they're going to change. I know Ebon Hawk is pretty strong. It would have been cool if they merged Ebon Hawk with Harbinger. I would have loved to see that, but that's obviously not going to happen. But Jung Ma, Prophecy of the Five, Shadowlands, and Jedi Covenant, I think most of those are dead. I'm not sure. I hear Shadowlands is going strong, but I'm not sure. Anyways, what I do want to say is be vigilant, guys. For those of you who have some experience with the GTN and you want to pick up some good deals, this is kind of a once-in-a-lifetime thing because eventually a few months will pass and prices will stabilize, economies will stabilize, people will kind of get a better sense of what to list your items for on the GTN and other stuff. But for now, take advantage of that like 1 month period of limbo where people are kind of confused, people are getting adjusted to the new economy, the new environment, and you'll be able to pick out some really, really awesome deals. You can definitely trust that I'll be putting out videos outlining some of the things that I think are better things to invest in and other stuff, but this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. We're actually seeing server merges go down, and we're actually going to see some economies change pretty heavily, in my opinion, and so this is something you're going to want to take advantage of. I'm thinking that I'm going to create a character who has at least level 10 on all the servers, and then that way I'm going to keep an eye out on all these economies and stuff and see what's going on. I'm actually pretty excited right now to just create some characters on like servers I've never been on, like Vangervalis Chain or I don't know, Prophecy of the Five and stuff. I've never really been there, and see what are those economies like? Are they dead? What's going on? And maybe make some speculation about how it's going to change. But it is exciting. It's all really exciting. Server merges is actually happening, people. Never thought it would happen. I know a lot of the other YouTubers and stuff had a really strong confidence that this was going to go down, but I didn't. And so it's kind of exciting to see this actually happen. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. Hope you guys are excited. As always, let me know what you guys think in the comment section. Will you be there to take advantage of these deals? I definitely hope so. Anyways, hope you guys enjoyed. I'll see you guys in the next one.